Good to see everybody. Hello, hello. I know, we're recording with a little bit more daylight than usual today, but, you know, most people are going to watch this at night, so I'm starting off with the autumn, nighttime autumn sounds, crunchy leaves, nature sounds on the back porch, crunchy leaves and crickets. This is when you have those straggler crickets that stick around. You say, which one is going to be the strongest? Which of these crickets is going to be the strongest? Who is going to be the last one chirping into the last? Then again, they all have a head start this year. It's in the 70s over here today in New York. Tomorrow, it's going to be near 80 degrees. Over the weekend, we're still going to be in the 70s. We haven't had a significant rainfall in many, many weeks, which has led to just wonderful, wonderful foliage. Wonderful. When it's nice and dry and even a little bit warm, but even, you know, that's when you get the best color, because all the trees, the leaves are stressed. Your tomatoes, your last bit of tomatoes that come out over the year, from the remainder of the summer, your tomatoes and peppers, they are nice, a beautiful red, because they're all stressed out from the dryness and everything else. I threw my tomatoes out though. It got to the point where it was starting to collect flies. I said, nope, it's the end of the year. Once you start seeing those like fruit flies show up, I said goodbye, as well as all of the pumpkins. We bought about eight. I told you guys about the assault that we've been under assault by all of the neighborhood squirrels. And it is a squirrel. This thing is working overtime. This one squirrel is getting very, very fat on pumpkin seeds and pumpkin rinds. Usually these pumpkins just rot in place. I told you about it. I'm not going to go on and on. But the squirrel is now just obviously addicted to the pumpkins at this point, because the pumpkins that they were not touching at first, we bought a couple of those bumpier pumpkins that look like they got some kind of a disease. Just wanted to decorate the front flower bed a little bit, all that stuff. First time we ever got decorative pumpkins. Something that we're not going to go and turn. Well, I guess a jack-o'-lantern is decorative, but still, first time we did that, because we had a place to put them. We saw the priority. We saw how these squirrels prioritize the pumpkins, and the ones that they weren't touching at first, they're just like, fine, I'll eat it. Now they're just like, fine, I'll just give me anything. I need more pumpkin seeds. I need it. I'm a fat ass. And this squirrel has gained at least 3 pounds. At least 3 pounds. It's not as big as a squirrel that Rob and I saw fall out of the tree when we were working out a few years ago. That was quite the sight. That was quite the sight indeed, to be working out in the park, to hear rustling around in the tree above you as we're on the pavement. There's some trees above us. We know that the tree, they're up there doing something, collecting acorns. All of a sudden the rustling stops, and 2 seconds later we hear just fly. It was like, you think about taking a hefty stake and just dropping it from 25 feet up. This thing went belly flopped onto the pavement, got up, ran off, and just like stood in the corner for a few minutes, just trying to collect its thoughts, thinking about what the hell just happened to me. I'm that squirrel that fell out of the tree. I've heard about squirrels that do this. Well, I'm one of them now. I don't know if he died. He left. Didn't find his body anywhere. He just seemed like he just needed a minute, because, you know, they're very flexible. They bounce just like all the other rodents. I have to imagine dropping I hope he's well. I hope his family's well too. And hopefully maybe he's in old age now, and he's telling all of his great grand squirrel children about the time that he fell out of a tree in front of two kung fu guys. And that'll be one for the record books. We have a few things to do tonight, this afternoon, but tonight, I want to take your calls. I got questions. We got some headlines. In the second half, I've got an article from Leo Zagami about an intense effort that true self-described witches are doing. You know, true acts, coordinated binding spell attempts to try to keep Trump out of the White House and push their favorite voodoo doll, Kamala Harris, into the presidency. That'll be in the second half. In the first half, we just got a little bit of headlines. We got something else, a few other things to do. I also want to do this with you right now. Here's the costume contest before we do anything else. I just want to show you. This was featured in the bulletin, the quite frankly bulletin in October. And obviously, if you are a monthly sponsor of the show, then the bulletin is one of the most amazing perks that you get, because this right here, the time that goes into this monthly bulletin is worth $50 a month. And the fact that you can you can sponsor the show for as little as $5 a month and get this on top of everything else, this is the business I'm in, man. I just want to create value for people, and I know it's going to pay off one day. In fact, I think in December we might make the bulletin public for everybody just as a Christmas gift to show you how awesome it is. Here is here's October. I just want to show you some of these awesome Halloween costumes in our contest. 2024, quite frankly, best Halloween costume contest of all time. It'll be the all-time next year, too. Look at this. Trump and Hillary. This was from 2016. Who did this? Dennis and Marianne LeBlanc. Now, these two actually ended up winning, but not for this costume. I'll show you later on. We announced them as winners a couple of weeks ago, but I just want to go through everybody else's. First of all, here's a little memory lane for me and Anthony. That's me as the mummy. You can tell by my eyes. Actually, it looks like Aurora. If Aurora's face was painted like a mummy, my father did face paint. That's what Aurora would look like as a mummy right now. It's before my nose got out of control. Oh man, I hope her nose doesn't get out of control. I won't say that out loud. Hopefully she keeps her mom's nose and her mom's hair. Don't be like daddy. Not like that, please. And there's Anthony on the left. He is Pennywise the clown, of course. He loved Killer Clowns. This is Lauren and her two sisters. Lauren's in the middle. She's the clown right there. And her sister Jen's on the left. Her sister Jess is on the right. Look at my little clown. Look at her. Isn't she cute? And then here's our creation. This was Aurora's first Halloween costume. As the skunk on the front lawn. This was literally a couple of days before she took her first steps. Just a couple of days she took her first steps, which made this an even better costume, because the fact that she was actually crawling to get around and she was on the front yard crawling around like a skunk looking for grubs. It was just too cute. Can't take it anymore. Such a cutie. Now here's me and Lauren at one of our Halloween parties that we threw maybe about 6-7 years ago. Gomez and Morticia Adams. Just wanted to throw this out there. It was a fun time. We did well. I did well as Gomez. Ha ha! I did very well. I just channeled my Raul Julia. And then here's me and Lauren on just a rant. I think this was before that. She was a lion tamer. That was her lion in her hand. And I think I was some kind of a carnival barker as well. But of course, I just had to smear blood on me, because you can't just be a carnival barker without blood. Oh, here's my cousin Sherry as a gypsy. Very nice. I'm sorry. She's on a flying carpet. I like those kind of contests, those things that cover up the legs and that visual effect of something going on up top, like all of the piggyback ride costumes that were really big in the late 90s. So there's my cousin Sherry. Here is Rob and Krista. I always love this picture. In 2020, they went to, I guess, at least one costume party dressed as 2020. A dumpster fire. Of course, Rob was a collection of all of the news of the day. There's George Floyd. There's all the riots and everything else. And then Krista, a redhead, just channeled that redhead fire and said, I'm going to be the fire. There's the dumpster fire. It's a great one. Very, very creative. Show up to a costume party as the dumpster fire of 2020. Now, here's some fan features. Right there, Cruella DeVille, that's Melly Mel from New Jersey. I know Mel very well. She shows up with her mother, Linda, to all the Jay Gulanello health retreats. We've all become very good friends. So there is Mel as Cruella DeVille. And we've got Elvis. Who's this? Ricky Deal, a.k.a. 10TCB. This is 2022. That's a pretty good Elvis. Good for him. Took it seriously. Good pose. Now we have Very, very tired couple. They've definitely been married for at least 10 years. Who is this here? Eric and Nicole from Carnegie, Pennsylvania. This is from 2009. This is before the shit really hit the fan. I can't imagine what these two look like now. Oh, my gosh. Who do we have here? A family. The Barber family celebrate Halloween in 2023 in Texas. Characters from Phineas and Ferb? I don't know it. But they know what they're doing, and I trust them. A little bit more. This is the Sentinel and Moliarty, everybody, dressing up together for Halloween at a nice festive, I guess, the channeling their flappers, the 20s. That looks like a 1920s party. So it might be a speakeasy party or something like that. I like that. The 1920s, let's charge it. It's the 2020s after all. Now, you didn't have to tell me what this was. This is definitely from the 90s. 1999, in fact. That is Queen Amidala on the left from Star Wars. Who is this? Captain Wiggles. Captain Wiggles, Queen Amidala, and her aunt. Oh, no, no. And who's this? Who's got the Spartan spirit going on from SNL on the right? This is Katie Sky from Texas, from Austin, lovingly dressed as a ghoul by her mom, Halloween 1990. I was 5 years old. I would have been very scared if I saw Katie walking around my neighborhood. I'd be like, oh, I don't know. I don't know if I can do this. Oh, let's see here. Mrs. McAdams and her husband, Tom, is Jack and Rose from Titanic. Oh, this is great. That's great. Hold on to that damn necklace. What the hell was she thinking, Rose, throwing that all away? Mary Sue and Jeff from Georgia. Bar hopping in Athens, dressed as costume as, what is this? Day of the Dead, Halloween 2015. Okay. The ambiguously gay trio, I guess, from SNL. They made it a trio. Who is this? John embraces a very gay Halloween on the Jersey Shore. Halloween 2000, the ambiguously gay duo. Ace and Gary. It's the Krasenstein brothers. Only they have a third, a triplet. Who do we have here? Matt and Val of Pittsburgh, dressed up at a local bar party. Perfect pair. Colonel Sanders and Chicken from 2023. Oh, boy. How nice. Good for you guys. And here is our winner. From the beginning, told you, Dennis and Marianne LeBlanc of Massachusetts. They are dressed up as Bruce Jenner and Caitlyn Jenner. Before and after, or this is after and before, but they were the winner. And I also just want to announce that we had a separate contest for all of the comments there, which obviously you can only leave if you are a sponsor. And the comment winner is Robin. So Robin, we're going to find you and we're going to send you a little something, and there you have it. That's the opening. It's 1:15, a perfect 15 minutes. When we come back, we're going to have fun with all the headlines and take your calls and do ourselves a representative show just in the middle of the day. That's all. So don't go anywhere. We will be right back, my friends. And that's all she wrote on the subject.
You live here?
Yes.
Well, maybe you know what a zombie is.
When a person dies and is buried, it seems there's certain voodoo priests who have the power to bring him back to life.
Horrible.
It's worse than horrible because a zombie has no will of his own. You see them sometimes, walking around blindly with dead eyes, following orders, not knowing what they do, not caring.
You mean like Democrats?
You let one ant stand up to us, then they all might stand up. Those puny little ants outnumber us 100 to 1. And if they ever figure that out, there goes our way of life. It's not about food. It's about keeping those ants in line. That's why we're going back.
Does anybody else want to stay?
Let's ride!
We'll be right back.
So you might have been, you might have guessed if I'm live right now at 1 p.m. in the afternoon, the Yankees won last night and prolonged this series. And the reason why I'm a little bit chipper is because they didn't win 3-2. It wasn't a squeaker. It wasn't just, you know, whoops, we won one. It turned into an absolute, something changed last night. And I don't want to, well, the Dodgers only threw their bullpen and not even their best arms. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. That's a risk that you run, too, when you go out there and you face a World Series team and you allow a team that was offensively anemic to get some hacks in and suddenly, perhaps, I don't know, create a little bit of momentum. Now, I don't care about anything other than having a good time. And all I care about is just win tonight, get the series out of New York, and it's up to you. I have no more power here, okay? I've willed this team, and I'm responsible for them getting this far. I'll take credit for that. But my mom and I, we just want to be able to enjoy a nice game tonight, have them leave New York, go to LA, and whatever happens there, so be it. We just don't want to see the damn Dodgers win in New York, and I'm sure Dodger fans don't want to see that either. I'm sure Dodger fans would like to, if they're going to win, win it at home. It'll be a lot more special, right? Can we agree on that? Let's just get it out of New York. We're going to win one more, and we'll see what happens on Friday. So we're going to leave around 5 o'clock tonight, and I'll make sure that I do some updating from the road, pictures of me and my mom, and that's actually going to be a part of the behind the scenes on the November newsletter, so be on the lookout for that. Here's one thing I do want to show you. It's a scene from last night's game. You don't need to be a baseball fan to appreciate this. I don't know if it's anything to be appreciated. It's so bizarre, and I'm actually kind of disgusted by it. It's easy to be disgusted by it. There was a play last night in the first inning where the right fielder for the Dodgers goes to try to make an out, does make an out by reaching into the stands, and he is essentially assaulted by two Yankee fans. It's the most caveman-like thing you'll ever see in your life. I was astonished. It actually looks, here, hold on. You have to look at this for just for a second. I don't understand what the hell. It's just incredible. Hold on, let me get out of the way here for a second. Now watch this. Mookie Betts, who's in right field, goes to make a play. I believe it's in the first inning. I was at the studio. I didn't see it, so I'm getting all the text updates. Watch what the fans do to him. Jumps up. Watch this. Hold on. Reach up. They grab his arm. Look at this. Look at this. Look at this guy. Look at him. Look at this animal. And I can't believe that this guy has fans out there. First of all, I said, okay, well, this can't be just is he disabled? I thought, I'm sorry. Sorry to say it. Forgive me. At first, I thought he had Down syndrome. But just became overwhelmed by the excitement of it all and just couldn't control himself and started grabbing at Mookie Betts's, glove and all that stuff. But no, he just looks like he has Down syndrome. But look at this. He's prying. They're holding him. And the guy next to him comes in, starts holding the other hand. Mookie Betts is being held up there like he's a prisoner while his glove is pried open. They're looking for the ball. Like, what the hell am I looking at? Look, he's prying it open. The ball comes ripping out. Look at how happy he is with himself. I couldn't believe it. First of all, these seats are at least $10,000 a piece when they bought them. The prices for the seats have absolutely collapsed ever since the Yankees went down 3-0. Collapsed. I'm almost sick to my stomach to see what I could have gotten them for, but you can't tell this stuff. But this is like unlike anything I'd ever seen before with fans and audience members, hecklers at a comedy club, being a little bit too overzealous and interfering with an event. It looks like footage. Just watch this. Watch this again. It looks like footage of an alien autopsy. No. Not an alien being dissected. Aliens dissecting an abductee. It You know, it's just like he's using all of his strength to pry open the right fielder's glove, reaching in like he's trying to tear out the heart of a turkey. His friend doesn't only find nothing wrong with this, but he helps hold down the abductee, physically restrains him while the surgery is performed. I mean, it's abominable behavior. Abominable. But it also needs to be studied. Like, what the? I couldn't believe it. I really couldn't believe it. And yeah, so I just wanted to throw that out there, a little something for the you know, the water cooler. All right, what do we have here? Supreme Court clears way for Virginia to remove 1,600 alleged non-citizen voters or non-citizens from the voter rolls. The Supreme Court on Wednesday allowed Virginia to remove roughly 1,600 alleged non-citizens from its voter rolls just days before the 2024 election. The high court granted a request from a state official to pause a lower court order that blocked Virginia from continuing its systematic voter removal program that was launched in August, exactly 90 days before Election Day. A provision of the National Voter Registration Act requires states to complete programs aimed at purging ineligible voters from registration lists up to 90 days before the federal elections. A provision of the National Voter Registration Act, okay, which aims to purge ineligible voters, which means non-citizens, but it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. CBS and the rest of the laughingstock media will go breathlessly into the night with their going against alleged non-citizen. Well, it's very easy to, I mean, how could you? Very easy to see if somebody's not a citizen, right? But of course, it's alleged. They want everything to be a question mark. Question mark on everything. What the hell? You shut up now. So this is going on. It's only 1,600 votes in Virginia. Please. I don't know what kind of an impact that's really going to make. If the margin of victory in Virginia is somewhere around 1,600, that I'll be surprised. But still, breathless. Supreme Court clears way for Virginia to remove 1,600 alleged non-citizen voters. So essentially what they want you to think is that there's going to be people out there alleging that American citizens who are registered to vote are going to be called non-citizens, I guess, because the idea that there is wide open pathways for people who should not be voting to vote, that's conspiracy theory, and it's contributing to a very hostile situation, according to our intelligence agencies. Don't you know? Didn't you hear about that? We got a real problem in this country, and it's the rise of the right wing. The rise
of the right wing.
Donald Trump just won't stop. He's already making false claims about ballots in Lancaster County in a Truth Social post, according to MSN or the Philadelphia Inquirer. Lancaster County was not caught with 2,600 fake ballots and forms all written by the same person as former President Donald Trump claimed on Truth Social on Monday. Trump, who has a long history of spreading false information about the Pennsylvania elections, took aim at Lancaster and York counties, both of which have reported encountering voter registration applications that showed signs of fraud. But Trump post drastically overcounted the affected documents and went beyond reality to falsely claim that Lancaster County has encountered fake ballots. Fraudulent, fake, ineligible, something's going on, but you got to use their nomenclature. Listen, the firewall is already up. Lone wolf, right-wing domestic terrorists, they're on the prowl and they can explode at any time. Hitler is already lying about the outcome. It's the firewall is already up. Already up. And Axios, who has become a very stylish member of this operation, had this to say. Congress gripped by fears of post-election violence. Lawmakers in both parties are bracing themselves for a tumultuous period after the November 5th election, with many openly expressing fears of political violence. Why it matters. Democrats in particular see it as virtually inevitable that Trump will challenge the election results if he loses. Virtually inevitable. Democrats in particular have also been the ones going out there, putting out in line all of the things that will be used to challenge and to reject Donald Trump's presidency should he win. Or should I say, should his reelection overcome every unseen obstacle that's been put in his way. Everything from Jamie Raskin talking about all the ways they were going to challenge it. The 14th Amendment was going to be used to challenge it. We already know from 2016 when they knew that they couldn't reverse the poll. All the recounts in the Midwest were just only, you know, giving Trump more votes. They couldn't turn it around. Hillary had lost. What'd they do? They went begging from the Electoral College to go rogue, to go faithless. It's Axios, it's the media, and everybody's lined up, okay? The firing squads on both sides, everybody's lined up, ready. But there's only one side that's the problem, apparently. And it's a side that never causes any problems. January 6th. If he loses, raising the specter of nationwide civil unrest or even a repeat of the January 6th
attack. An attack. You don't want to be attacked again, do you? Be scared.
Very.
Very scared. One House Democrat told Axios, "I'm gay." What does that have to do with anything? Oh, here you go. Oh, sorry. Here it is under there. One House Democrat told Axios they are extremely,
extremely
concerned about violence and hired half a dozen state troopers to provide security at their election night event, a significant boost over the past years. I wonder what could have raised the tension on all this stuff. You know, I wonder what could have been. I wonder why people are so uncivil. Republicans, on the other hand, claim the real threat will be from the political left being unable to accept another Trump term. That's where all the problems have been. That's where all the problems have been. You know? I mean, 2020 is, what was the story of 2020? Oh, Donald Trump mismanaged a virus that showed up out of nowhere and he ruined the economy. And then when he rightfully lost, all of his supporters rioted on January 6th, completely skipping over the entire year of arson, looting, wanton murder, gang activity, and actual terrorism. Terrorism is violence. Violence with the intention of having some kind of a political impact. And that was what was going on, especially outside the White House. I mean, they try so hard to stack bodies that are associated with January 6th, and all they can do is point to a couple of very dubious, suspicious accounts of officer suicide that nobody has ever gotten to the bottom of, and I guess will never get to the bottom of. On the other hand, Democrats, the far left, the Antifa, Black Lives Matter crowd and all that, they're foot soldiers, put Secret Service and God knows how many, however many other feds into the hospital, dozens of them in May of 2020. Oh, it's bad. But this is the media. This is where we are. The firewall is up. The gaslighting is to unspeakable levels. Thankfully, I think that a lot more people, they've lost a lot more people, but they are hunkered down. The trenches have been dug. And God, I mean, just get ready. Just get ready, ladies and gentlemen. Get ready. because there's a contingency plan for literally everything. There's a contingency plan for if it's inevitable, that there's no way that they can actually overshadow and negate the reelection of Donald Trump. And then, of course, there's plan A, which is don't allow him the opportunity to even believably claim that he had won. There are those two things: to try to take this damn thing like they have in the past, just act as if and LARP their way to another whatever the hell it is, and then it is it's just minefield. Activate the minefield and make sure that we can take off a couple of limbs. That's what they're doing here. The state of play: federal and local law enforcement are already ramping up security across D.C. The Secret Service confirmed to Axios that security enhancements have been made to the Capitol in the run-up to the certification of presidential electors on January 6th, including fencing erected around the Capitol complex. I'm telling you, it's going to be a thing going forward. A thing going forward. I was leaving when I was at the when I was at Madison Square Garden. There is always somebody. Every once in a while, you'll get people. They're non-confrontational. They're waiting for a reason to actually get in somebody's face, but they like walking down the line of Trump supporters and people who just wanted to be there to be part of the energy and just be a part of it all. And you'll hear them talking to each other as they walk, laughing. They make sure that they talk to each other loud enough so that everybody online can hear them, but they're not being addressed. Very passive kind of a thing. Like they're laughing, like, look at all these fascists and stuff like that. And I heard these two girls must have been like college sophomore, freshman, something like that. One girl said to the other one, "This is dystopian as fuck. This is dystopian as fuck." What? And I chuckled to myself because she's just a nitwit. Like, what's dystopian? People of the line waiting to get into an event? That's dystopian? Or is the fact that, I mean, these are just words. These are just words that they have taken on. The fact that there is any support, there could possibly be any support outside of whatever they have been roped into, whatever they've been indoctrinated into, the fact that people can exist outside of that is somehow dystopian. And they wouldn't be able to tell you why. They couldn't put any kind of, they can't put anything on there. But this is the thing that we have been groomed into in little bits and pieces culturally. That mindset to see, you know, to put to gray wash everything, and to see everything as, oh, this is disgusting and whatever. It's dystopian to see anybody that has a different opinion than me feel happy and excited about getting together. It's not a Nazi rally. They were, you wouldn't be, I mean, seriously. And then it's other things like this, physical things you never get away from. Election day is no longer one night because we need at least a week. We need at least a week to make sure that everything is just right. Just right. So then what's been wrong in the years past? What has been wrong in the years past, I ask? You know, I mean, here's another one for you. Oh, and just so I can finish my thought. Election night is no longer one night. Get your mind off of that. Mail-in ballots are an X factor that will make every secure lead seem like a mirage. And of course, we have a rising violent right wing in this country, which includes disaffected Democrats, gay people, black people, people of Hispanic, European descent, everybody. I mean, every demographic, every shallow metric in which they measure worth, it is actually best represented in the group that just disavows what the hell is being brewed on that side of the scale. That, of course, is the predicate for locking down D.C. every year, making it a military-occupied optics that we are in a state of war, that, you know, everything that we used to have to take into consideration about our military gallivanting overseas is now a problem here in the United States. It's probably going to get even worse because the new Al-Qaeda is the right wing. It's the right wing. And of course, right wing is just anybody who doesn't feel comfortable with the lowbrow, low IQ dealings of the DNC, which even that is just a facade for a much larger operation that includes people from both so-called parties. And that's dystopian right there. That's the real dystopian thing. So they say things that may actually have a modicum of truth attached to it, but they don't know why, because they're just playing a role. You know, they're playing the role of the strong, you know, those two girls were the young, sharp, the young, sharp Zoomer who can see the world and is not taken by the bullshit, but is really just a mind slave, has nowhere to go. And Axios is right there giving them all their 5 a.m. talking points. It's nuts. The Capitol Police turned heads on Monday, performing a casualty evacuation exercise that involved landing three helicopters on the east front of the Capitol. So there you have it. Congress is gripped by fears of post-election violence that they have created the possibility for. Every day they work toward that possibility, because if they don't and people are just chill, then that's it. Like I was talking about last night with Grace. When the topic of Hitler or the Civil War pops up, it's not necessarily when you go into a controversial topic and you are not you're not dissuaded from reading text or listening to speeches from someone like an Adolf Hitler or anything else like that, that you're going to naturally come to the conclusion that they were good people, that you would want them to be around. I know some people would do that. Some people but that's not naturally what's going to happen. What will happen is that regardless of what you get from people, you're not going to be subject to trigger words. They want the Civil War. They want Adolf Hitler, every aspect of the dropping of his name to be a trigger into action. It's a reaction, a revulsion, anything that has been, you know, affixed to the Hitler brand must be stayed away from. Donald Trump, Hitler, terrible. So that's the whole thing we were talking about last night, being able to free yourself from the mind control by not being afraid of information, not being afraid of people, being online at a Madison Square Garden rally. You know, I got opinions of all types of people based on the way that they vote and whatever, but dystopian, I don't know. I usually just feel bad for them. Michigan will count thousands of overseas ballots from Americans living abroad, arriving up to a week after Election Day. And you know what the response to this is? Just simply, sorry, no. If they come in after Election Day, they're being thrown in the trash. You've created this paradigm in which anything is a vote. Anybody could be a potential voter. And there's so many ways of casting your vote. And you start with this shit, with the early voting and absentee voting and all that other stuff, so many months in advance. You can't get people to put it in the mail in time for it to arrive on time. Like, is there any responsibility left? Is there any accountability? Any. Michigan will count thousands of overseas ballots from Americans living abroad. Sorry. First of all, if you're living abroad and you're not here and you still have any care about what happens in the United States, then mail it 3 weeks early. Well, were you busy? You were too busy to check a box, put a stamp on it, and throw it into the mail? No, we have to give them at least a week after the election. Sorry, no. No, you don't. Ridiculous. So it's just things like that that don't make any sense. What else do I have for you? At 1:38, we're making great time. I have something that I want to ask you, and I'm just going to throw it out there because we did a lot on the behavior of the media last night. It has... It's found its way into the show here tonight. I asked the question yesterday when we were looking at the laughingstock media and all the things that they're rolling out day in, day out. And here's a question I had for everybody. Has anyone ever done a thorough investigation into what exactly happened to Matt Drudge and the Drudge Report? Okay? But it's one thing to say that it's not that, you know, the website is trash now. Absolutely. But it was such a huge factor. It moved the needle in big ways. And it still, you know, brings in a lot of traffic. But what? Who's in control of it? When was it handed off? I can't find anything on it. And I put it out because I just want people to sleuth around a little bit. I'm going to go through some of the comments. M. Petrus said, I vaguely remember Matt Drudge saying he was not willing to risk his life for the truth or something to that effect, which eventually led to what I believe was him selling the platform. Was his life at risk? Yes, that could very well be true. Sounds like he moved on and is staying invisible. Because I don't know anything, you know. So, and then I asked, okay, so it was sold? If so, when? Here's another one. Drunk Surfer says his last public appearance that I'm aware of was when he showed up one day on the Alex Jones show. When that was, I don't know. Let me see here. Jared says, I think he saw where the media was going in its transition to socials and sold while he can get his money's worth. Just my theory. Yeah, but that doesn't make any sense because still, you know, if you're on social media, you're using the internet. It's not like the Drudge Report showed up as a pamphlet every month and it was just a vestige of the 1990s. It's still very much, you know, part of social media. People are going there and getting their news aggregated. It's all hyperlinks. People are tweeting out links all the time. It's big. So there's that. But a fine point, something to consider. Lefty Magnet says, it's a mystery to me, but I will say that Citizen Free Press has done a great job taking up the mantle. Yeah, they have. Only, whereas I love Citizen Free Press and I go there often, the solitary, I love the three columns of Drudge. And Drudge mixed in a lot of other interesting things a lot more often than Citizen Free Press does. And Citizen Free Press really does go really heavy-handed with the pro-Republican, pro-Trump stuff. And I don't care about it, you know, being pro or what. I just want to see something worth reading. Like the Drudge Report, you would get a little bit of everything. But now it is just pushing. It's pushing Kamala Harris. It's pushing the left. It's piling on with the ridiculous projections of crazy cognitive decline of the right wing and the real problems, the societal problems being on the right, anybody who is conservative on their shoulders. I don't care about somebody being supposedly pro-Trump because I don't know if Matt Drudge was ever really pro-Trump, but there was still utility with the site. And I only bring it up because it was such a massive site. It was so massive. If you got a link on the front page of the Drudge Report, I mean, you were, you know, you, especially if that happened every so often, you were going to establish yourself as a serious player in new media, especially as it was coming up. KM says he was told once by Scalia that he would never be allowed to keep the Drudge Report as it was at the time. I'm not sure if he quietly sold it because of that, but I believed it was sold a few years after. I'm not sure exactly, but Barnes Law said that he sold the Drudge Report years ago, and one of the requirements was that he couldn't acknowledge that or something like that. Could that be why he is radio silent? If it's NDA related, then absolutely. That's from Virginia Conservative. Good question, people are saying. A couple other people said, hey, we should have some bitch I know do a dive and see what's going on. Other people are suspecting blackmail. But if it is a part of an NDA, a part of a sale, then it wouldn't be. It wouldn't be blackmail. It's just, okay, you got your payday. And if we're going to preserve any part of the traffic that's going to be on over there. It can't be made known immediately after the sale that Matt Drudge is no longer a big part over there and that some Media Matters group working through a shell company that puts a buffer between them and George Soros is the one that's actually in charge of a once very powerful brand that is just off the rails. It's off the rails. And we spoke about Washington Post last night, Jeff Bezos trying to reestablish that so that it's a viable brand going forward and not just an absolutely tone-deaf, crazy commie rag. See what he does with it. I don't know. I'm never going to be a subscriber one way or another, but still, it just got me thinking about Drudge because it's nuts. And if you've been on the internet long enough, you know how big that has been. Okay, let's go and take a really quick break. When we come back in the first half, we're going to start with your calls. I want to get you guys calling in. Open lines, absolutely. Open lines. Don't go. Actually, no. I'll save the break for the second half. Let's just take your calls right now. 914-200-0269. 914-200-0269. Give me a buzz. I want to hear from you. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to bring up a little bit of a Roman history thread by a recent guest, Alex Petkus, who was on with us. He's the guy who quit academia to teach in the alternative news and media spheres. And we had a great conversation about all those things and talking about what is a legal vote and what is not a legal vote. I'm just going to throw this out here. And while I read this, I'd love for you to call in and to get yourself ready for a little bit of the first half, some first half thoughts. So here we go. Alex Petkus, host of Cost of Glory. In the late Roman Republic, legal tampering with voting rolls caused the great first civil war. This happened by sudden, massive additions of quote-unquote new citizens by legislative fiat. The parallels to today offer many lessons. Background. In the 100s BC, so second century, there was a widespread discontent with the elites. The oligarchic establishment was getting rich. Forever wars, petty plundering, government contracts, foreign bribes, importing cheap labor, inequality skyrocketed. The Gracchi brothers were the first ones to do something about it in the previous generation. We spoke about that when he was on the line with me last week. But the greatest of the dissident populace was the general Gaius Marius, 6 times consul by 100 BC. He used the Gracchi's playbook, leveraged discontent, bent the rules through plebiscites. Wait, hold on. Did I get the previous? Oh, I'm sorry. It's not first century. Second century AD, it's 100s BC, okay? Going back about the discontent with the elites, I said the second century. Just want to make sure you guys know that we're talking about 100s BC. Should have said that. So Gaius Marius used the Gracchi's playbook, leverage discontent, bend the rules through the plebiscites. Marius finally ended the forever wars, conquering Jugurtha and the Cimbri in huge conflicts. He's got a very, very prominent face, doesn't he? He has the nose of a Dr. Seuss character. By the late 90s, however, Rome's allies, the Italians, were demanding voting rights and citizenship. Arguably, they deserved it. They'd shed much blood in Rome's wars. That's one important difference with the U.S. situation. Marius saw opportunity in these new potential citizens. Marius' rationale was as follows. Whoever grants citizenship to hundreds of thousands of non-citizens will get a permanent 100s of thousands strong voting bloc. If you struggle to get enough votes in the elections, just import new voters that are loyal to you. Every serious Roman saw what was at stake. Now, this actually goes into a little bit my modern-day concerns about what is going to be done with the illegal aliens that have been brought here that have done no good for the country, stand to provide no good for the country because they are coming here under pretenses of just needing some money, having absolutely no real care or interest in our culture, in our history, and in our future. wanting a payday right now. So my whole thing here is that, are those people going to be bargained with and said, hey, well, most of you are military age males, and we have 77% of our youth in the United States can't do a pull-up, a push-up, and are mostly pre-diabetic. Would you mind being soldiers for us for a few years and we'll expedite your citizenship? I'm worried about something like that, which would essentially turn the United States military into a de facto UN fighting force. But, you know, here in the past that we're looking at right now, we're talking about people who had already fought for Rome that are now being brought into, I guess it's the same thing. I guess it's the same thing, only they're putting the cart before the horse here in the United States. Every serious Roman saw what was at stake. But in 91 BC, Roman establishment elites outmaneuvered Roman populace like Marius. The nobles tried to co-opt the Italian allies by offering them citizenship. Livius Drusus was the aristocrat pushing this. Unfortunately, he was murdered. Why murdered Drusus? Maybe the Italians deserved citizenship, but this would massively alter the electoral map and disadvantage poorer Romans, and many elites too. Many fine speeches were made about these good, deserving men, but again, serious people knew the real stakes. With citizenship hopes dashed, the Italians revolted. The incredibly bloody social war ensued from 91 to 88 BC. Many Italians were offered citizenship as a concession to keep them loyal, a legislative fiat made possible by the chaos and desperation of war. By 88 BC, the social war is over. Gaius Marius sees his chance. Because the newly minted Italian citizen were gerrymandered into electoral irrelevance, major Roman elections used a weighted voting system. It's complicated. It's probably like over here in my town where they use this cumulative voting bullshit where everybody gets 6 votes each. It's horrendous. Marius has a friend draft a bill to fix this issue. However, Marius empower the Italians legislation would be passed in a popular plebiscite, a non-weighted popular assembly. This bill thus enjoyed decisive support from the new Italian citizenry, but Marius added a key rider to the legislation. The rider said this, that the consul, Cornelius Sulla, be removed from command of the Mithridatic War, and Gaius Marius be given charge of the war. Marius wanted control of the Mithridatic War, a huge opportunity for plunder, patronage, and glory. So what's the trick here? The key point, Marius used a popular citizenship issue, empower the new voters, as a popular leverage for naked power grab. Make Marius general. Classic Roman mob boss politics. I do favor for you, and you do a favor for me, but it backfired. Because Sulla, the current general, powerful optimate, an establishment politician, was still camped in southern Italy, instead of obeying the decree, he turned his army around and marched on Rome, thus beginning the first Roman civil war, a story that we've covered elsewhere. The lesson, every serious Roman knew, new citizens, new voters, are one of the most powerful political leverage points. It's never just about what's best for Rome. What schemes can you pull off with new voters loyal to you and your political party? I think we all know what's at stake here. Let's take a call. 845, what's on your mind? Go ahead.
Hey, Frank. I'm busy here making up my Halloween arsenal. I got a case of Barbasol. I stole the tops off of like 4 or 5 VO5 hairspray cans. I got a case of eggs, and I got some pins and the cans of Barbasol. I don't have the VO5 tops for. I'm going to make into real straight shooters.
Well, you know, you'd be doing something that kids around here don't even know about anymore. Mischief night is just not a thing anymore. I saw somebody's house TP'd the other day, but I suspect that that's probably a local football player. You know.
I was actually going to throw that in. Is that I got about a half a case of toilet paper in the basement, and just for shits and giggles by myself, I was going to go knock down a mailbox on the way to TP to our neighbor's house.
Yeah, it's usually just like a local football player, the cheerleaders. I think they still go out and TP the football players before homecoming and stuff like that. But it's you know what? You know what? Fine. I'm fine with the Mischief Night thing dying out because nobody has any good spirit anymore.
You know what? When the paintball guns got involved, that's when it went weird. But yeah. About the mid-90s, the paintball guns started coming out. Like, I'm talking like I was born in 75, grew up in Queens, and we were about 10 years old. Nine or 10 years old. My dad, like, went out and got us shaving cream, and we weren't allowed to have eggs. But we got to go out with the teenagers and bomb. And it was just shaving cream and eggs. That's all it was. There was no paintball guns. There were no firecrackers. It was fucking awesome.
Yeah, I know. Depending on what happened to you, you knew if somebody liked you or if they didn't. Like, there was something that going around that if you took, like, if you went to a convenience store, like a grocery store, and grabbed yourself a package of Oscar Mayer bologna or something like that. If you threw bologna slices on a car, it can hurt the paint. Or if you put sugar in somebody's gas tank, that's very destructive. Like, depending on what was happening, you knew if it was just out of fun or if obviously somebody hated you.
And I'm sure much like other stuff went down, but like we would just come home covered with fucking shaving cream. The teenagers got drunk and stoned or whatever they did. And it was fucking normal. It was okay.
Yeah, it was a good time. It was always
a great time.
Yeah. Okay. So that's
right. I got a thing. I think this is going to be punishment for the owners of the Dodgers, not the players. God bless them. You know, you work for a team. But the tranny nun thing.
Oh.
I think it's not going to go so well for them.
Oh well. Hey, from your lips to God's ears. Thank you for the call. Yeah, I forgot about that. The Sisters of Whatever, where they let all the cross-dressing nuns onto the field, and but the response to that was fantastic. There were so many thousands of Christians, Catholics outside praying the rosary, and they never really paid for that. That would be some nice justice. Again, like I said, I'm completely divested from stuff like that. I never made any pronouncements, any predictions. I just hope that it got to a game five, that I'd be able to take my mom to one of these games, see a World Series game for myself as well, and have it not be an opponent clinching game. All right? If the Dodgers win tonight, we will see them celebrate a World Series victory on the field. I don't want to see that. If it's going to happen, let them do it at home. We just got to win the second game tonight. And there was a lot of positive momentum started last night. A lot of positive momentum. Let's see here. Let's go to the super chats real quick. Rosie Rose has a very happy and many ass smacks. Happy birthday and many ass smacks to our dearest Linda Love from her friends on Gilded. Yes, it's Linda's birthday. If you see her, please smack her ass and say happy birthday. Jay Britt says hot dogs on me tonight. Jay, I love you, man. But you know that will just be one hot dog, right? Now, that'll be a hot dog for my mother. That's fine. If that's what she wants, maybe she'll have some garlic fries. I don't know. But we're talking first pitch, 8 o'clock. I should already have stopped eating 3 hours prior to that. So thank you so much. And my mom says she's hungry tonight. I'll say this is on Jay Britz. But you have no clue how much the hot dogs already are in a regular season game. I've never seen World Series prices for anything, especially World Series prices for parking. I'm holding my breath. Let's see. Hey, King, what's up?
Hey, how you doing?
How you doing?
I'm glad you got your game five, man. That makes me happy there for you.
Yeah,
I'm pulling them back.
Yeah, I appreciate it. It's, you know, it's one of those things where it hasn't happened in 15 years. So to see an opportunity like this, I say, well, it's more so for me and my mom. And let's see if it's good to go.
Yeah, that's a beautiful thing. And I ain't got a problem with what them guys did to Mookie Betts. I would have punched him in the fucking face if it was me.
You would have just...
And that's kind of... I would have, yeah, for real. But that's kind of tame to what we used to do at old Yankee Stadium. We used to throw batteries at the opposing outfielders. So I don't know what everybody's so up in arms about.
You would have just punched him in the face.
I would have, yeah. Okay. Yeah, that the guy would have grabbed his glove and I would have been his buddy and I would have like fucking clocked Betts right square in the fucking face.
Right. Well, that's... I hope it would have been worth it. You know the thing, the crazy thing is, man, I was expecting, because it was just so crazy to see them, to see both of his wrists get held down while one guy pried open his glove like you would pry open the chest cavity of a turkey and try...
The Bronx, baby!
Dude, I don't know.
Welcome to the Bronx, Mookie Betts!
Oh, my gosh. Incredible. So we'll see what happens tonight.
Well, I hope you and your mom have a great time, brother. Mm-hmm. I really do.
Well, thank you, man.
All jokes aside.
Thank you. I'll see you. And
You're welcome.
I'll talk to you a little bit.
Yes, sir.
All right. Well, here, take a look at this. I got this, I got to take a picture or so with my mom tonight, and I'll post it on Instagram. But here is, I don't know, this is 1997 or 8. We were sitting on the third base line. That's my mom. There's me. Anthony was there, too. He's probably taking the picture or something. My mom is holding up that baseball and holding her stomach because she had just got struck. That is a ball that was hit by Tino Martinez. Foul ball down the third base line. It came in like a missile. And before we could react, she got hit right in the stomach. Oh, just wanted there's me in my neon Yankee jersey. So you never lose me. If I was walking around the stadium and don't know where Frank is, well, yeah, just look for the goofy hat and the neon jersey, and there's Frank. No problems there. So that's just a little homage to all the many, many times we've spent in that stadium. And I think her stomach has since recovered. All right, let's go on a really quick break. When we come back, we have so much more to do. So much more to do. And I'm glad we're doing it together here. It's 2:00. 2:00 p.m. on a Wednesday afternoon. So strange, isn't it? All right. Don't go anywhere. Be right back.
It's intermission time, folks. Time out to press the like button. Thank you.
Welcome to intermission. Yeah, intermission.
Entering, quite frankly.
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 Quite frankly, guys.
Quite frankly.
Quite frankly.
Quite frankly.
So everybody watch. Quite frankly. With Frank.
Quite frankly.
How dare you?
Okay, hold on. I got a couple more pictures I can show you. Why the hell not? 'Tis the season. Oh, here's a picture of me and Lauren. I have a lot. I mean, there's so many times. Me and Lauren in Yankee Stadium. When was this? This must have been like 2009. Me and Lauren, Yankee Stadium, 2009. My GETTR football jersey. Here's another one, me and Lauren. I didn't know she was behind me. She photobombed me. How dare she? Oh, but my favorite picture of me and Lauren at Yankee Stadium, right here. I asked this this guy, I think he was like a Chinese guy or something like that. He didn't speak that good English. And I said, here, can you take a picture of us? I was high, by the way. I was stoned. Lauren might have been stoned too, but she always hides it better. And I said, here, take this picture of us, please. And he went and took it. And as you can see, he had his finger over the lens of the camera. And that's me saying, oh, wait, you got your finger on the lens. That's me saying, you got your finger on the lens of the camera. That's my favorite picture of me and Lauren at the stadium. We take other good pictures together, but no, oh, that's like, oh, wait, that was one of the chill. We had a good time there. And I don't know. What else do I have? Oh, there's so much. Wait, I can give you another one even farther back. Let me give you another one farther back than that. Facebook pictures. I downloaded all these when I said to hell with. Oh, here's one. Here, you want to see the kind of access? The kind of access that little kids like me could get back in the day? Oh, here you go. Here is, look at that. Look at that collarbone. Look at that collarbone. That's before Frank put on some muscle. But I don't know how old I was. Maybe 10. Less than, yeah. No, yeah. Probably 10. That's like 95, 96, 10, 11 years old. I'm sitting on the dugout, guys. You know what you need to be able to do to be down there at this point? Do you know what you know the people you have to kill? You know the limbs you need to sell to be sitting where I was sitting right there? They just let you down. I mean, this was just during batting practice. We got so many things. Oh, that's the old stadium too. It just felt good. And we'll go back there tonight with my collarbone not bulging out of my shirt. Just one of those things, you know. You grow up, your metabolism slows down. You grow up, your metabolism slows down. You can make a wish with that collarbone. Yes, legacy rant. Holy shit, legacy rant. Wait, has he been here the whole time? Jerry Coogan is here. Now, I understand that we're going to have more people. We're going to have more. Francois Nada says that he was high, too. Oh, the guy taking the picture of me and Lauren. Yeah, all three of us were probably stoned. Oh, man. See, a midday show is always going to bring in people you don't see a while, especially all of our friends in Europe. And I'm really excited about all this. Good times. Okay, let's see. I did a break. Let's get to your calls again. Oh, I got some questions that are coming from directly from the audience. So let's do that, shall we? Captain Cast Iron says, I was talking to a friend that Big Brother is using medieval tactics with modern technology to execute its diabolical plans. God bless and stay free. Yeah. Medieval tactics with modern technology is a good way of putting it. Now, Captain Cast Iron, if there's anything you want to say on that to elaborate, I can come up with a few things. But in particular, if you want to, I mean, there's always been need to kind of scare people into subservience. There's always been a need. Obviously, that kind of psychological, the head games and all that stuff, that has been it's been tried and true. People are always trying to manipulate others, especially to the benefit of themselves, their careers, their kingdoms, their fiefdoms, whatever it is. But, you know, in a medieval sense, you can only really control so much because you don't have any mass communication devices. What we have right now is, I mean, it's pretty powerful. It's pretty powerful, and it is still, I mean, even though it's becoming more and more regulated, and even in some, like, undetectable ways, a little bit more stifled, it's still very, very open-ended, and so much can be done. But if you have anything you want to expand on that assessment, please send it in, because I think it would be a really interesting mini topic for a show coming up after tonight. Okay, let's see. Jay Semo says, enjoy the game. That's on Rumble Rants. Thank you so much, Jay. It's good to have you guys over there. Quiet, cozy little crew. It's the middle of the day. You know, most of the people who watch live are not going to be here, but it's all right. I'm thinking about taking this off of YouTube right now and re-uploading it and premiering it at 7 o'clock. What do you think about that? What do you think about that, ladies and gentlemen? Because I think that YouTube would flag me if I uploaded something that was identical as far as the file itself. So I wonder if I can re-premiere it. You think I should re-premiere this at 7 o'clock? That would be nice. I don't know. I'll figure it out. Let's see here. Let's see. On Pilled, Robert Sarnes, thank you. No Stud All Muffins says, enjoy the game, Frank. Thank you. Steven and Lori says, can't stay. We'll catch the replay. Have an awesome time tonight, Frank and Mom. And Delona sends a fleet. You guys are wonderful. On Subscribestar, here's a few ones. Jay Britt says, in Studio A, the lighted bookcase shelf to your right, what is the cigar vibrator-shaped item? I've often wondered. Jay, I have no clue what you're talking about. There is nothing on... Let me get an episode of me in the studio last night. I've got to see what vibrator you see in my... Vibrator. What the hell does that mean? Hold on a second. Window. Let me see. Just me. What behind me is a vibrator? I'm looking at it right now. It's from last night's episode. There's no vibrator. What are you hallucinating vibrators? I don't get it. What are you talking about, Jay? I don't even know how to answer this. I'm seeing vibrators everywhere I go. There's nothing there. I assure you. It's not like, the Spice Girls music video. Jay Semo says, years ago when I was in college, I went to a Yankee game and went down to the field level. Oscar Gamble came over and tried to pick up my date. It was hilarious. Sounds hilarious. Let's see here. Isabel says, why the Joker look on your logo? Well, that's not the Joker. That is Stanjic. That is it's a jester, more specifically. It's a famous piece of Polish art, and there is a really awesome story behind it. Kind of like the melancholy jester who is more aware of the toll of the war that is going on than all the politicians at the party behind them. We've done that quite a few times over the years, and it's just I think it just really embodies a lot of the approach of the show. And I love it. I always loved it. So it's not a joker. It's a jester. And there's a difference. Kiss Chaos says, if you could interview Art Bell or Alex Jones in studio, who would it be? Maybe. Oh, I don't know. Maybe Art Bell, only because he's gone. And that would be an incredible get to be able to interview a dead man. You know, to have him back for an interview, in his pre-deceased state, by the way. I don't want this, monkey's paw kind of shit where he shows up and he's just like crawled out of the grave. That would be weird. But Alex Jones is still, I would never scoff or pass up an opportunity to have Alex Jones in studio or on the show. Why would I pass that up? But Art Bell, that's something else, because that is a pathway to talking about so many interesting guests and people he's had conversations with. I can get a little bit more out of him about Malachi Martin. Tomorrow night for Halloween, we're going to have Dr. Albert Taylor back on the show, the Soul Traveler. So we're not only going to be talking about out-of-body experiences and the astral plane, but we're going to be talking about a lot of his paranormal investigation work. But he has a very rich history of being on coast to coast. He has been on, with Art Bell going back to the mid-90s, and he made his final appearance on Art's show with Midnight in the Desert, I think in 2015, just a couple of years before he died. So they've known each other for decades. And I'd never asked him any questions about Art Bell. I should ask him, do you have any Art Bell stories that you'd love to tell here on Halloween, which is, such a big you know, ghost to ghost kind of a thing. You know, I'd love to ask him about that. Any Art Bell stories? Because they're friend, they had to have become friends over the years. They're always on each other's shows. Him and Sean David Morton. And I have to go check up on Sean David Morton. That guy is fighting like hell. Fighting for life. And just a really good guy. And has always been a supporter of the show. Hello? What the heck is this? Who are you? Who are you?
Aurora.
You're Aurora? Mm-hmm. Why are you so cute?
Says I'm a ballerina.
You're a ballerina?
Yeah.
Are you practicing your ballet?
Mm-hmm. Before I was, but now my ballet class is over.
Well, your ballet class is not over. You're in here. Okay. I was gonna say you don't touch. Just right where it's supposed to be, you just talk into it. Well, that's great. So you're practicing your ballet?
Yep.
Did you have a good nap?
Yeah.
Good. Very nice. So what are you doing out there?
Nothing much.
Hey, why don't you say happy birthday, Linda?
It's her birthday.
It's Linda's birthday. Say happy birthday, Linda.
Happy birthday.
Okay. There you go. Okay, so Daddy's almost done. So how about you go hang out and you do some puzzles or something like that? And
actually, I am, but I'm going to eat some pistachios first.
Oh, you're going to eat some pistachios first, and then you're going to do some puzzles?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll be out there soon, and then we get to exercise together and all that stuff before Daddy takes Mimi to the baseball game.
Okay.
Are you excited about me going to the baseball game with Mimi?
No.
Why?
Because I'm not coming.
Oh, no, don't say things like that, Roradu. Don't say things like that. You make me sad.
But tomorrow I want
to
see you.
Yeah, tomorrow you're going to see me.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Love you, rosy cheeks.
Love you.
Okay, see you in a little bit.
And if I need you, I will call you.
Yes, if you need me, call me. I'll be right here. Okay, so there you go. And Linda says, what are you going to be for Halloween? Well, Aurora was a bumblebee, and I was a beekeeper. So, I was a beekeeper with Lauren. That's what we got. Okay, let's do a really quick break, because I got through all the super chats. When we come back, I'm going to read this Halloween ritual planned by Satanists and witches to make Kamala Harris president. This is featured, one of the latest blogs featured on Leo Zagami's site. So I just want to read through this and then take your calls the rest of the way with whatever you want to talk about. That'll be good. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Peter, congratulations. This is one heck of a promotion.
Thank you, Bob.
And we'll go ahead and get some people into you right away.
It makes me wanna creep. Damn. It makes me wanna creep.
I got something for your mind, your body, and your soul.
Damn, I'm such a G, it's pathetic. Here comes the big-headed, and that's dipping, sipping on Kovacic.
goddamn, I must have the floss today. Now pimping ain't easy, but it's necessary. So I'm chasing bitches like Tom chased Jerry. I put the pedal to the floor in my two-tone Ford Explorer. You know how it's done. Sound bumping, ain't that something? Jumped on the 110. She's flying in the blazer like Ghost Speed Racer, but I ain't gonna chase her like Racer X. But I won't flex till it's time to have sex. So when you wanna get together, cause you know a nigga like me is down for whatever. Damn. And I'm down for whatever.
Well, that was easy.
Damn, it feels good to be a gangster.
You guys like that Office Space edit? Hats off to Al Gorbachev and Krista for putting that together. That's all original. That's all original right there. That was not jacked. That's all us. But if I put it out there on Twitter, it will get jacked. Anywho, down for whatever. Okay, so let's see here. Ladies and gentlemen, a Halloween ritual planned by Satanists and witches to make Kamala president. Will it work? This is an article by Leo Zagami. Each month, under the glow of a waning crescent moon, thousands of American voters, who also happen to be self-identified witches, gather online and in person with one goal: preventing Donald Trump from winning the presidential election, armed with orange candles, tarot cards, and not-so-flattering photos of the former president. They cast a spell to block his return to the White House. The final words of their synchronized ritual, "You're fired," echo as Trump's image burns to the ground. As I explained in an article that I published back in 2017 regarding one of the originators of the Trump binding spell, quote, "What most people don't know is that the person responsible for organizing this ritual is a Christian liberal Freemason named Michael M. Hughes." That's obviously an oxymoron, a Christian Freemason. He lives in Baltimore and is the author of both fiction and nonfiction that is regularly promoted by the liberal media. When he isn't writing, he speaks on Fortean about paranormal and other topics and teaches workshops on the tarot. What is most important is that Michael Hughes is a Freemason and a member of the Societas Rosicruciana, a Christian Rosicrucian organization where membership is by invitation only and is regular mainstream Masonic affiliation. Michael Hughes branded this evil initiative Magic for the Resistance, publishing a book about it in 2018. As I outlined in Confessions of an Illuminati Part 7, the initiative, quote, was praised by one of the current leaders of the OTO named Lon Milo Duquette, who I have written extensively about in Volume 1 of my Confessions. Duquette is a staunch leftist and Bernie Sanders supporter who wrote in the introductory praises of Hughes' infamous book, "Then Put Your Magic Where Your Mouth Is. You Might Want to Start by Reading Magic for the Resistance." In Volume 7, I also show in detail how Hughes and a group of black magicians devised this infamous ritual for binding Trump, which they have rehashed to help Kamala. Quote, "They're turning to the supernatural because they feel like they have no other choice," end quote, says Sabina Magliocco, a University of British Columbia professor who studies the modern witch movement. Quote, "They are looking up to tip the scales in their favor using whatever means possible," end quote. This month, on the eve of the festival of Samhain, about 2,000 years ago, is considered a very special moment of the year by Satanists to perform certain magical rituals that will favor their goals. Oh, I'm sorry. On the eve of Halloween, something unprecedented will take place. 100 women with many more probably joining on the day, across the United States, are invited to virtually gather on Zoom and light their yellow candles for another infamous ritual. This creepy ritual begins on the evening of the Festival of Samhain about 2,000 years ago and is considered a very special moment of the year by Satanists to perform certain magical rituals that will favor their goals. Halloween has long been claimed as the high holy day of satanic worship. This is the day when witches and warlocks gather to praise their leader and extend his work on Earth. Festivities are marked by unprecedented evil and blasphemy, with blood sacrifices and hedonistic practices playing prominent parts. For this reason, the followers of Anton LaVey, the founder of the Church of Satan, who died on October 29, 1997, even went to the extent of changing his death certificate to the date of October 31, 1997. Remember, we were just talking about that with Tony Merkel not too long ago, about the inside baseball of LaVey's loss of his soul, the literal detaching of his soul. While with eyes closed, the anti-Trump witches will create an egregore and visualize a future where Kamala Harris is president. Each witch will focus on this vision while their candles symbolize clearing obstacles from Kamala Harris's path to victory. Which, of course, there is, you know, the only obstacle is that nobody likes her. They are putting obstacles in. This is probably why this stuff doesn't work for them. You know, if Kamala Harris is injected into the White House, it's not going to be because these fucking LARPers and these cat ladies, these cat piss people are out there lighting candles and burning tarot cards and throwing darts at Donald Trump's pictures or something like that. Because they're, again, their assessment of the situation, their assessment of the playing of the battlefield is just completely, the premise is completely skewed. What's standing in her way? I don't know. Just general appeal. What are you going to do? It's like love potion number. You know, this is exactly like this whole thing. Like love potion number 9. Love potion number 9. You know what's so ridiculous about love potion number 9? I mean, it's a fun song. It's on the autumn playlist that I put out there on Spotify for the show. It's a fun song. It's a classic song, but it makes no fucking sense. When you make a love potion, it's usually to make people like you. Someone that doesn't like you, you want them to like you back. You want a love potion, just whatever. This idiot goes out there, gets a love potion, drinks it, and it turns him into a sexual assailant. I'm kissing cops. He's kissing a cop. He's kissing everything in sight. It's like, that's not how a love potion works. It's supposed to get you some reciprocal love. Meanwhile, this idiot drinks love potion number 9. He's kissing police officers and telephone posts. It's so stupid. It's the same thing over here with these witches. It's like, we're going to remove all blocks from her path to victory. Her block, the people behind her, she's a voodoo doll. The people behind her are putting blocks in somebody else's way. She has no appeal. So it's so stupid. You know, I don't discount the black arts and the ability for people with, malintent to go out there and put human intention to the test and actually manifest something. I don't discount that, but I don't know how you can possibly have any success when you can't even really understand the situation that you're in. You know, it's just so sad to see all this LARPing. The evil witches have called this special ritual against Trump the future casting, and in the center of it all is a certain Wendy Houseman, a D.C.-based witch who left her corporate career to practice witchcraft full-time, leading a coven of professional made up of lawyers, doctors, and executives, according to her. Houseman guides them through rituals aimed at shaping the political landscape in what honestly seems more of a gathering reminiscent of Polanski's movie Rosemary's Baby. Quote, "It's giving us agency where we don't have any," Houseman said in an interview. And according to her, the more future casters there are, the stronger the magic is. That's why she plans to invite her 25,000 mailing list subscribers to join in for this and other possible political rituals for the election. You know, these are the people who say that prayers don't work. Just remember that. They say that they say that thoughts and prayers don't work. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, they are getting all as many of their most their intelligentsia as they can together to go out there and put, just like that that news media woman that we were talking about in 2017 or 18, who was talking about the hexes that she puts on people that she stopped doing because she thinks that she killed a few people. These are in the media. These are, you know, a leading coven, a coven of professionals made up of lawyers, doctors, and executives. Wendy Hausman. Such rituals are performed, Leo goes on, by what are clearly Illuminati-controlled witches and warlocks across America, and they are aimed at securing a Democrat win in 2024. The other monthly ritual that might be conducted after the election, depending on the outcome, is the one devised by Michael M. Hughes, who suggested these rituals have gained momentum in participation as the election nears. Quote, there was a renewed energy from witches once Kamala got the nomination, he said. Yeah, there's something about that sacred feminine that they like twisting and inverting and riding like a crazy horse to the stable. However, some self-proclaimed witches say such spells won't work against Donald Trump, and one witch strongly advised against it, suggesting everyone practice spells in favor of Kamala Harris while leaving Trump out of the picture. Here's a quote. I hate to say this, but don't do magic against him. He has a form of protection surrounding him that feeds off magic done against him. Yeah, he's anti-fragile. You will have better results if you focus your magic on helping his opponent or protecting yourself and others. I wish it would work to bind him or to do a freezer spell, but you will only be helping him. End quote. This is from that Reddit post that we were talking about last week. It's true, Leo continues, that Trump has spiritual warriors creating, as the witch said, a form of protection around him, and they are calling on divine intervention to bring him back to the White House. Many Jews and Christians from all denominations are rightly seeing Trump as God's chosen leader. Or at the very least, somebody who will protect Judeo-Christian values. In a recent open letter to American Catholics, for example, Archbishop Carla Maria Vigano, who practically denounced Kamala Harris as an infernal monster who obeys Satan, wrote the following ominous warning. Quote, In Kamala Harris's America, Catholics, but also Protestants, are considered fundamentalists to be marginalized and eliminated, and their children are considered the property of the state, which arrogates to itself the right to lead them astray from an early age in both body and soul. Trump's America can become great and prosperous again. Harris's America is destined for invasion and moral, social, and economic destruction, the most ferocious kind of dictatorship. So this is going on. So we'll see what happens. We will see what happens. This was published on the 26th. Well, hell, I mean, if you think that this is not going on behind the scenes, no matter how effective or ineffective it is, it's happening. It definitely is. Okay. Let's see here. 236. Let's take some calls. We're riding this one for another 24 minutes and we are off. That is a full 2 hours. And I think I'm going to redo this. I think I'm going to rebroadcast this at 7 o'clock on Twitter and perhaps even on quitefrankly.tv. Maybe I can re-premiere it on Rumble as well. I'll look into it just because, you know, I want people to hang out, get together and enjoy. This is a really fun stream. Good stuff in it. Okay. Let's see. Okay, 914-200-0269. Neo says, I think Jay Britz is talking about the green spectrum analyzer EQ in the bookshelf. The green spectrum analyzer? You're talking about the radio? The audio signal? I mean, why would he think that that's a vibrator? That doesn't make any sense. No Stud All Muffin says a Studio B show isn't complete without an appearance from beautiful Aurora. Yeah, she is. she's something else when she shows up like that, isn't she? She usually goes down for a little bit of a nap around 1 o'clock. So there we have it. All right, guys and gals. Well, listen, if that's it, I can always get off early. But give me a buzz on the flip side of this, and we can go and take this for a little while longer. But that's all I had for you tonight. Is it Friday Night Extras? I had the Halloween ritual. We did all of our questions. We did a little bit of Roman history, a little bit of headlines. Talked a little bit about that ape man that assaulted the right fielder of the Dodgers last night. That King thought he should have actually punched him in the face. And what else? Oh, we looked at all the costume contests. We found a winner from the comments. And I had to generate a winner from those comments, but it was a good odds to win because there was only 4 comments. So please, if you are a subscriber, please go ahead and do so. And that's it. I guess that's all. All right, 2:34. We're going to post it. We're going to post it here. I hope that you guys have a wonderful evening. And really, I don't know. I'm looking forward to coming back on the air tomorrow night. Maybe I'll have some really awesome things. Be on the lookout. Oh, hold on. Of course, now everybody's like, no, don't go. And here comes a couple of calls. Jules, what's going on? Jules from Maryland. Oh, hold on. Wait. The music. Okay, go ahead, Jules. Start from the beginning.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, no. I just wanted to call and say I'm jealous that you guys get to go to that baseball game tonight. Have you put out where you're sitting, or do you not want to do that? Because we want to be looking for you in the crowd.
Oh, you will never see me.
Wear that lime green shirt that you
have. yeah maybe
wear that. Okay,
no. The cameras do not venture up that high. That's here, Jules, let me tell you something. And it's just one of those things where before a series like this starts, or you know, anything, any kind of public event like this starts, you don't really know how far it's going to go and whatever. So people at first, you just have to say, all right, if I'm going to secure myself some tickets, we got to do it now.
Bite the bullet.
And so if what I paid, Jules,
no,
I would be able right now, because of course the Yankees lost the first 3 games. They're on the brink of being swept. So if I were this morning to say, I want to go to Game 5. I went to StubHub to see what the tickets were like. For the price I paid for 2 tickets for nosebleed, I could have taken a family of 4 and been on field level.
That's what I was going to say. You're sitting down there in a box.
I swear, the price of the tickets depressed so much. If you are in the area and you have an extra $700, you can be on field level right now. It's insane.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, yeah. I'm sick to my stomach. I actually called StubHub and said, hey, listen, I don't care about a refund. I don't care about a refund if I lose a little money on this, but is there any way that I can use what I've spent already to just get a better seat? I tried. It's sickening. We could be on the field.
Lord. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Well, good luck. Keep your head on a swivel. We will be watching just to see what happens, because I'm just surprised that they pulled it off.
I know.
But hey, amazing.
I just want them to pull off one more night at least so that we don't have to see
that
happen.
That'll be great. That will just be great.
Right. Well, thank you, Jules. Oh, my goodness.
All right. Okay. Talk to you later. Have a good day. We'll see you later. Bye.
Thank you. Keep me in your prayers. Keep me in those thoughts and prayers that the witches say don't work. Of course they do. Let's see here. Hello. You're on the air. Go ahead.
Hi, it's Melanie.
Oh, Mel.
How are you?
It's Cruella DeVille.
Yes. I didn't catch the whole show, but I'm working right now and I have you on my web browser. So I was able to catch the tail end.
Good.
But, I just wanted to say my cousin Megan was able to go to the Trump rally last night in PA, in Allentown.
What'd you say?
She said it was amazing. She was standing in line for like 3 hours. The whole thing was, you know, sold out. And she said she couldn't even get anything to like eat or drink because the lines were so long when she got in. But I was definitely very jealous.
You know, have you ever been to one, Mel?
So believe it or not, back in 2020, before the world ended, my sister and I went to the March for Life in D.C. And okay. I saw him speak there. So, but that was the only time I got to see him speak live. So,
got you. I don't know. I've never been to a rally. I did see him show up to one of when we went to. There was a march that Tracy was a part of in 2018,
mm-hmm.
and that was a great one because after we all got together outside the White House and got to hung out. Later on that night, we met up at the Trump International. I've hung out at the Trump International twice, just, you know, everybody's just milling around and whatever. But one of those times, Trump was there, and we got to see him.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he was having dinner up top, and at some point, he was leaving dinner. We all got to crowd around. He came by and, you know, waved us. We saw Melania. He didn't speak or anything like that. Didn't been to us, but, you know, there's no rally. But this would have been a rally, but I didn't get in, so there you have it.
Like, so hard. It's so cool that you got to be there with the people and so the energy. It's always interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. It was something. It was just good to be out there. There was a whole lot going on. You're in the middle of a whole lot of humanity all in one place. And yeah, head on a swivel. Like the last caller said, that is certainly something you need to do because unfortunately you don't know what's going through people's minds and everybody is so emotional, but
yes,
it's fun. It is also very, very, it's just also very fun to be a part of.
And I just want to say one last thing. We did vote early. My mom, my Brandon, my sister, and it was packed. I was shocked. And even Brandon, when he went, he had to wait for 30 minutes on a Sunday at like 5 p.m.
Gotcha.
So I'm feeling hopeful. I know that's probably a little, but hopefully.
Hold on. I just heard the last thing I heard was you're feeling hopeful and then you broke up. So what's the last thing you said after that?
Oh, no, just we'll see. I really hope that it goes in our favor, you know, for the sake of the country, for the sake of, you know, everything. But I'm nervous. I'll be excited once it's over. The election.
I understand. And I got to say, it's just one of those things where it's just not. I don't know. It's You almost just like say, hey, please, a little bit of intervention would be great right now because, yeah, the other side will be upset, but the other side really doesn't even know what's good for them anymore, and
yeah,
I hate to say that because it seems so paternal and didactic and tyrannical, but here's the thing: what is the alternative? And thank you for the call, Mel. When I say they don't even know what's good for them anymore, is it that, well, here, take our plan instead. There needs to be less done. It's not let me do what I want to do to you instead of what you want to do to me. Let me do less across the board. Now, I understand that one way or another, these are two parties that have very progressive cores. I'm not a Republican. They're progressive to their core. And a lot of people like me, if you are going to vote at all, are voting for Trump again. Because on that level, regardless of what you think could be done to reestablish sanity in D.C., which I think nothing can, on that level, to even get 1% of the pressure removed from our necks, 1% taken away, stripped away, which I would love to see a total stripping. Then again, if this is not just rhetoric about the income tax and tariffs, there has to be a major peeling of the onion, a major peeling of the onion. There is no way that the military and welfare and everything else can be sustained by just, you know, putting a tariff on Chinese imports of steel. There's no way it can happen. So there has to be a true realignment. And you want to know something? For as much as it needs to be done with the deportation of illegal immigrants, especially those who are brought here with the only sponsored by international NGO types and our own government. They were sponsored to come here with the only reason of supplanting whatever's left of Native Americans to try to democratically supplant us, American citizens, okay, who have been here, who have a lot in the game, who did things the right way. If you're a new arrival, come all over the world, who wants to be able to take part in what's been built here and hopefully be part of its solution to be revamped. But aside from that very necessary need to deport people, we need to deport a lot of people in the federal government. I would love to see most of the 2 million federal workforce deported back to the private sector or back to whatever state departments pop up in the wake of a federal department shutdown. That would be great. Okay. Let's get rid of the Department of Education. I would love to see state departments of education become more robust because all of that money is not getting wasted by having it stolen and dispersed amongst the states illegally and all that stuff. That's what I would like to see. We need a deportation of nearly all the 2 million people who are effectively a pro-big government voting bloc who will never want to see true American reform to this government because that means the end of their jobs and their pensions and everything else. They got to go. Sorry, there's probably great people there who love this country, but it's just they got to go. So that's the real deportation I'm looking for, because how many things have been destroyed, how many things have been hindered, and how many controversies have been concocted out of nowhere with the help of these faceless bureaucrats that you can't get rid of? They got to go. They actually might be more dangerous than the illegal immigrants, at times at least. So that's what we have for you tonight. Hey, everybody, say some prayers for safety for my mother and I and a good time. And whatever happens, we'll be back tomorrow and enjoying everything. It'll be Halloween. Also, remember, we will be going live at 8 p.m. tomorrow. 8 p.m. because we're taking Aurora trick-or-treating. I'll be live here from Studio B. We have the 8 p.m. Halloween show with Dr. Albert Taylor. Afterwards, we have the final book club gathering. So I posted the Monkey's Paw on the forum. Go over there and check it out. Read it. It's a quick read. It's spooky as hell. And we'll get together tomorrow night. It's going to be a nice one. And then we're into November. It's All Saints Day. And, well, you know, we're going to need the Saints to come marching in soon. Because God knows what the hell else is going to happen. Thank you, guys. Thank you all. I dumped out the treasure chest on D Live. I released the scratching on Pilled. You have been very generous to me. Let me see. We're all caught up with the Rumble rants. We're all caught up with the super chats, and that's it. Enjoy yourselves. Bye bye.
I'll catch you on the flip side.
Quite Frankly is filmed before a live studio audience, and now our super chatters, starting with Captain Cast Iron, Rosie Rose, and Jay Britz. Another happy birthday to Linda, who is getting her butt spanked so much by everybody in the chat room. I'm sure she is raw. And thank you to our Rumble Ranchers and everybody else. We will see about rebroadcasting this tonight at 7 o'clock across a couple of sites, just so you guys can have a little bit of together time with each other. And have a good night. Take care, everybody. And be on the lookout for updates from the Quite Frankly Instagram and Twitter tonight, as I will be posting, hopefully, from the stadium at various times. Good night.
Storming the castle.
Think it'll work?
It would take a miracle.
Bye-bye. Bye.